to new session in R. Today we are going to talk about nonlinear functions. So in chapter 7 of your textbook, we covered many different methods, including polynomials, polynomial regressions, including step functions, logistic functions with polynomial arguments, with polynomial entities or arguments, functions. So today we are going to have two videos. The first one is going to work on the classical algorithms that are there, which are polynomial regressions and polynomial logistic functions and step functions. In the second video, we are going to work on more sophisticated versions of nonlinear functions, including splines, smoothing splines, natural splines, local linear regressions, and of course, the most amazing state-of-the-art function, general additive models. So let's get started. To use polynomial functions, we require ISLR. And since I'm going to use data frame weight, we just attach it so that we have easier time to work with the variables inside it. So one thing I want to emphasize on this data frame is that capital letter wage is different from lowercase wage. And so lowercase wage is the actual data point in capital letter wage data frame. So please know the distinctions. Capital letter wage is data frame, and wage here with lowercase w is our variable. So let's get started. So we want to predict wage based on age. That was the first thing we wanted to do. So let's start it with the basic function we have. So let's call it fit poly basic. So we want to have a linear model. Our y variable is wage, that is lowercase wage, by the way, and we want to see its relationship with age. Age squared plus age to the power of 3. Remember, the I functions are going to create a new variable based on what you define inside. If you introduce a logical argument here, it will become a true and false outcome. If it's not, then it will create another function. So, for example, here we want to regress wage on age, h squared, h cubic, h to the power of 4, and our data is capital letter wage. So when you write such a thing in two lines, please make sure you you keep all lines when you run it. Okay, so we have the outcome. So let's look over summary fit poly basic. So we get a couple of variables here. These coefficients are non-orthogonal coefficients, so we cannot talk about them on their own, because there is some relationship between these coefficients and these coefficients. They're not independent. So in order to get orthogonal coefficients, we need to use the function poly. So we can do the same thing. Let's call it fit poly this time. The linear model of wage over polynomial of age and 4. Let's say degree is equal to 4, or you can just put 4 or degree equal to 4 and keep it as 4. The data is wage. So look over this variable. It's 2.12 e plus 0.1 means 2.12 times 10 to the power of 1, so it's 21.2. So when we run the same model, but based on polynomial functions here, instead of breaking down to ih squared, ih to the power of 3, and so on and so forth, what we will get is our orthogonal coefficients. So let's look over the summary of fit poly. So just for the sake of this example, just remember this coefficient. The coefficient for h square is minus 5 times 10 to the power of minus 1, so it's 0.56. But here, when you just look over the coefficient for fit poly, the second coefficient is negative 478. So this is the orthogonal coefficient. It doesn't have, it's independent from the coefficients here. So you can describe them standalone. And that's a great thing. So if you have a choice of choosing poly or do it this way, I always suggest use poly. Okay, so that was something we had before, but always finding the confidence intervals are as important as finding the outcomes. So in this course, we are trying to construct confidence intervals for our predictions. So again, like before, we need to have some data to predict our outcomes based upon. So let's look over data that exist in age. So let's look over the range of age. So the range of age is from 18 to 80. So the range function gives you what is the minimum of your variable, what is the maximum of that. So if you want access to 18, you just call age 1. If you want to have access to the second component of age limb, you just write 2, okay? So it's 18 and 80. So from now on, whenever I write age limits 1, that means I'm considering 18. Otherwise, I'm considering 80. In our first sessions, I taught you a function that called SQL. The SQL function creates numbers between a minimum and a maximum with some increments. If you do not introduce its increments, it just assumes the increments are 1. So let's create some variables from 18 to 80 and call it age grid. So what we're trying to do now is to create a variable that changes from 18, goes up to 80, and the variables are one, each unit of this vector is one unit more than the previous one. For example, you have 18, 19, 20, and you have this sequence up to 80. So if you just ask for age grids, what you get would be a series from 18 to 80. So age grids have these functions. So now, let's try to predict our function on these values. So for every value of age, meaning 18, 19, 20, and so on and so forth, let's predict the outcome of that. So in order to do that, we should have access to our model. Our model was fit poly. Our new data would be the ages that are the same as age grids. So we want to evaluate this function in a new variables for age which change from 18 to 80. And this is something we add to it, and I explain what it is. That is the standard error of our estimates. We want to save that as well. Otherwise, the predict function does not give us this value. Okay. So let's look at the values of predict. So in this variable, we have fitted values for every age level, standard error of fitted variables, and degrees of freedom, and residual scale. The two ones that we are going to work with are fitted values, meaning that the response of our fitted model on different ages we have here, and the standard errors of our model. So in order to have access to that, so if you, for example, if you want to have access to fit component of predict, you just write your name of your variable, which is pred, and as always, just write fit. Here you have fitted value for all outcomes. For instance, this is our prediction for age 18 years old. Why 18? Because our age grids started from 18 and went up to 80. 81 is our prediction on age 80, which was our very last age limit we had. So if you look at the standards, that's the same thing. So if you like write pred of standard error of fit, SE of fit, SE of fit, what it gives you is a standard error at each point. For instance, that is the standard error of our estimate for 18 years old. This is standard error of estimate for the age 19 years old, and so on and so forth. Okay, so in order to introduce our confidence intervals, we have to introduce a new variable, and we should put it in a vector. Remember, confidence intervals are the 95% confidence interval is roughly 2 times the standard deviation of the error plus what you predicted. So the predicted value. So let me write that. The 95% confidence interval is roughly, so it's approximately 2 times standard error. So if you want to have the upper limit of confidence interval, you should add your fitted value to 2 times the standard error you estimate for that. You want to have the lower level confidence interval, you should subtract 2 times the standard error from that confidence interval. So here we are trying to introduce the lower bound and upper bound. So as before, we need to have our predicted values plus 2 times the standard error of our fits. Let me start with that will be our upper limit confidence level, and then we can add it to so the only difference will be negative that predict fit minus 2 times predict standard error. So now we introduce a variable SE band is actually a vector, it's actually a matrix for each element. For each age, it has the upper limit of confidence interval and also lower limit of confidence interval. Maybe if I just do this, it will be more readable. Okay. So SE bands now has the confidence intervals, confidence levels we are interested in. So let's plot age and wages. Let's plot our raw data, and let's color it as dark gray. Argument binary, let me check. Oh, is equal to, okay. So that will be this messy, oops, that's a very large outcome. Let me make it smaller. There you go. So that will be our real outcomes. As you can see, there is some nonlinearity here for sure. The youth earn less than middle ages, and when they reach 80 years old, since they're usually retired, they earn less. So we see this nonlinearity, and we are trying to capture that. So that is our raw data. And now let's add our 2 other lines to it. One is our prediction line, the other one are our confidence level. So let's write lines. We want to predict. So remember, our predictions are based on age grid, which was from 18 to 80. So that's our X variable. Our Y variables are our fitted values. If you want to define the length of your, the width of your line, use LWD. The larger this number, the thicker your line. And lastly, what you need to do is to define the color of that. If you don't do that, then you don't get a beautiful shape. Let's make it blue, my favorite color. Again, I think I had a mistake somewhere here. Let me double check. Pred line age grid is not found. Okay, so let me see what maybe that. Oh, that is grids. Okay, age grids. So it just adds to the value of it just adds the fitted model to our original data, and it makes sure every tool line is connected. For example, that is our prediction on 18 years old. These are prediction on 19 years old, and it just connected with a line. That's what the line function does. Now we are interested to add the standard error bar errors there as well, our estimates as well. So if you want to draw more than one line, you use matrices of lines. I don't know what MAT stands for, but my guess is matrices of lines. And that can be done very easily. So we want to have age grid as on our X variable. Remember, the SE bands, the standard of error of bands, had two elements, the lower bound and upper bound. So if you want to draw them simultaneously, let's put it in mat lines. Let's keep the color as blue. Usually standard errors are shown by dotted lines or broken lines. And the way to show that to R is using LTY. So that's the line type. If you set it to 2, that would be broken line. Oh, again, grids. Okay. So now we get this beautiful polynomial of degree 4 with the estimates of our standard errors times 2 plus our fitted values, which are our confidence intervals. As you can see, at these tails, this confidence interval starts increasing. And that's usually the drawback of using polynomials on themselves. Specifically, if your polynomial level is more than 4, these standard confidence intervals become wider and wider, and that means you're losing predictability in extrapolation. That's very good in interpolation, but extrapolation is not that well. Okay, so that's about adding confidence intervals to our polynomial models. One thing that is very handy in R is using ANOVA function. And that has been used when you have nested sequence of models. Let's say you do not know which model is the best, but which degree of polynomial is the best. So what you can do is to introduce different models. Each model has one more degree of flexibility, and you just write it down, and then you use a very simple function called ANOVA, and it tells you which model is most significant, so which level of sophistication or flexibility is the best. So let's call our very first model fit A that regresses wage on education. That's a simple linear model, data wage. Let me repeat that a couple of times. Okay, fit B is the same thing, but polynomial of that, of degree 2. That means not only is it linear, but also it has the square function in it. Let's define a couple of more functions. Let's call them C, D, E, and F. 3, 4, 5, 6. So the only difference of these consecutive models is that it has one more degree of complexity or degrees of freedom. Education is not fun. Oh, my mistake. That is education, not education. Education. That's number of unique points. Okay, so let me double check what's going on. Okay, fit A is fine. Fit B is not fine. Why? Okay, our data is wage. I'm slightly I don't know what's going on. Education, there's nothing wrong with that. Oh, education was okay. I know what happened. Education was a factor variable we cannot put in polynomial. So let's add age to it. So, okay, so let me change our models. Since education was a factor variable, we could not put it in a polynomial. So let's work on another variable. So let's try to add age to it. And each time, let's try more level of sophistication for that age. So let's use age 2, age 3, age 4, and age 5. Okay, so let's call it B, C, D, E, and F. Okay, so let's see what these models are doing. The first one only has education as a predictor. The other one is a linear function of education and age. So this is 1 degree of freedom. This model has 1 more degree of freedom than the first one, has more flexibility. The next one uses age in terms of polynomials of degree 2. So it's 1 has more degrees of freedom and so on and so forth. So the last model uses 5 polynomial of degree 5 for age. Okay, so let's run all of them. Okay, and now if you want to just compare these models, use a very simple function called ANOVA. And that is amazing because it does a lot of good things. It tells you which model is the best by cross-validating statistically. Okay. Okay, voila, here is our here are outcomes of all 6 models. The one has the highest F statistic is the best. So this model is the best that you can get. That is, it is our third model, which is wage with education and polynomial degree 2 for wage. So you can use that in projects and homeworks. That's a very, very, very easy thing to use and very, very powerful thing to use. Okay, our next topic is logistic regressions with polynomial functions. Again, we have covered that before. The only thing I'm trying to add to that is building up confidence intervals for that. For that, we need to change the log odds to probabilities. So let's start doing that. So let's let's focus on this graph first. Let's focus on that one. As you can see, there are some people who are earning 250 and above. The rest are earning less than 250. And we want to find the probability of being here. That's what we're trying to estimate based on age. So we want to partition our data into high-income people and low-income people. I'm not sure if a person who is earning 230 will be categorized as low income, but let's see. Let's say our cut point is 250K. We call 250K and above wealthy people, and the rest non-wealthy people, or they're not poor people certainly, but not that wealthy people. So it's very easy to do that. At R, you just write use GLM. We had it before. For logistics, fit logistics would be GLM, You can easily introduce, since our wage is no longer a quantitative variable, but also a categorical variable, we should teach the function what to use. And we use it with these indicators. If you write I of wage more than 256, it's a logical term. It returns true when it is actually more than 250, and it returns false when it's not, so that's how we categorize things. So now it understands our outcome is a categorical variable. Let's regress it on polynomial degree 3 of age. The data we are going to use is capital letter wage. And remember, if you want to run logistic regression, you should introduce family binomials for that. Okay, so now we have a fitted logistic model. Let's look over it. Some of our variables are not significant, some are, most of them are, but let's work on this one. Let's use it in predictions and see how things are going. So let's start predicting it. Again, I'm going to use the same age grids we introduced earlier. So we're going to use the same thing. So prediction of our logistics regression is predict. So what is our model? Our model is fit logistics. What is our data? Our data, let me write it down. New data is, again, like before, that's a list of age equal to age grids, the variables we introduced. And remember, we want to build up confidence intervals, so standard error should be true, should return that as well. So now we will have a model that not only has the predicted values, but also the standard error of each predicted value at each level of age. So let's see what it gives us. It gives us fit. SE of fit, residual scale, it doesn't give us degrees of freedom anymore. So what we need is just fit and standard error of fit. So here we are trying to do something very cool, and that is introducing and putting all our fitted value, standard error, fitted value, upper level of our confidence interval and lower level of confidence interval in the same matrix. So how we do it is using, again, C binds, but there is a cool thing to work on that. So let's call it SE bands. Remember, we need to have our predicted value. That's what we always need. How do we get access to that? That is our variable, our model, dollar sign fit plus C bind 0. I explain what that does. Let's call it fit. Lower, let me put it here. Okay. Lower equal to minus 2 times predicted value of logistics, SE fit, and also our upper limit is 2 times predict logistics, SE fit. So let's see what that function does. So what it does is that it adds the fitted model to 0, and that will be the first element of that matrix. It adds the fitted prediction of logistic model, fitted models, to negative 2 times the standard error of fitted models. That would be our second element. Last element would be the fitted model plus 2 times prediction model. So the first element would be our fitted model. The second element would be the lower bound of our confidence interval. The last one would be the upper bound of our confidence interval. So this SE bound has everything that you want. That's a matrix, 3x3, that has everything that you want. So let's look over the first three values of that. Sorry, first five values of that. It has the fitted value. That means the fitted value for age 18. And remember, the fitted value is just log of odd. Log of odds for 18 years old. Log of odds of being among people who are earning 250 and above is minus 7. The lower bound of that is minus 10. The upper bound of that confidence interval is minus 4. So let me write. The outcomes are in terms of log odds. But as you remember, it's an easy way to change log odds to probabilities. In order to change log odds to probabilities, probabilities, we need to use logistic function. And for those who cannot remember that, logistic function was p was equal to exponential of whatever you have divided by 1 plus exponential of that. So we exactly do the same thing. We call it probabilities. We call it probability bands. That would be exponential of our SE bands. That means it does it element by element divided by 1 minus plus exponential of that. So now let's look over these probability events. Okay, that's a very cool thing to look over, but let's see what it says. So remember, our very first age that was considered was 18 years old. So for 18 years old, there is only 0.04% chance on average that they be among top earners, the people who are earning more than 250K. The 95% confidence interval for that prediction is 0.00002, that which is 0.002% chance, to an upper limit of 1%. So that is for 18 years old. So let's look over the same thing for people who are, let's say, 40 years old. Or let's say, 40 years old. 40 years old people, on average, 3.4% of them have probability of being among those people with the confidence interval of 0.2% to 5.1%. And here is our prediction for the oldest people in our population, which was 80 years old. He had a chance of 2.7% to be among top earners with confidence interval that is 0.09%, and goes up to 46%. So that confidence interval is huge. So let's draw what we found and see how these plots look like. Since we want to draw three lines simultaneously, we use matplots. R X variable is age greed. Our Y variables are probability bands. It has all the bands. It has lower bound, upper bound, and fit. The first element of that was fitted value. The second one was lower bound. And the last one was upper bound. That is what I love about R. You can introduce the length of the line separately in one line. For instance, usually, the fitted value should have more width than the other one. So, the first element of this matrix, this vector 2, says the fitted value should have width 2. And also, the confidence interval is lower width. So, that's why we put 1 for that. So, it tells R that the, for the first element of our Y, which is probability bands, which was the fitted value, use width 2. For the second value of that, which was the lower bound of our confidence interval, use 1. For the last one, use 1 as well. You can do the same thing for the type of your line. So LTY, again, usually confidence intervals are shown by broken lines that and it understands it by line type 2, and usually the fitted values are shown by 1 and its type is just line. Okay, so that shows our logistic outcomes and it creates this beautiful probability function. And as you can see, things are very crazy for older people because we use polynomial degree 4. Later on in the course, when we talk about splines and other very state-of-the-art techniques, we learn that we can do better than that. Okay, so that's about logistic regression. And let's talk about the very last topic, and that is fitting step functions. So if you remember, fitting step functions were functions that needed some knots, and in order to use knots, you have to use function cut. Cut just breaks your range of your variable into different categories, and it tries to uniformly do that. Unless you introduce the breaking points. For example, let's look at what would happen if we cut a variable age into 4 units. If we cut, remember we had the youngest person we had in our population was 18 years old. The oldest person was 80 years old. So 80 minus 18 is 62. And if you want to divide it into 4 units, each unit should have 62 divided by 4, which is 15.5 range. That is why it starts from 18, goes up to 15.5 above that, which is 33.5. That would be our first group. The second group would be 33.5 plus 15.5, which is 49, that would be our second group, and so on and so forth. So that's what cut does. And everything is very, very easy. So the fit step would be the linear model of age, wage on the cutted areas of age when your data is wage. So that is the basic thing about linear models and step functions. So if you want to see how it predicts, it's just like before, you just write predict your new variable based on your fitted model based on the grid. So I suggest you do it at home and see and try to draw it and do exactly the same thing we did before and try to draw this step function plus the confidence intervals. Okay, so here was the course about 3 different things: polynomials, building up confidence intervals for them, and then logistic regression lines with polynomial elements, and lastly step functions. In next video, we are going to work with some state-of-the-art functions for nonlinear relationships.